down. Fire time.
Wolves take the lead.
Good evening and welcome to Brazel Stadium on the campus of Grand Canyon University for Antelopes baseball. The Lopes come in at 9-14, 3-0 in conference play, and face the only other unbeaten team in the conference, the Northern Colorado Bears at 11-12 overall, but 3-0 in the conference as well. Utah Valley came into the day undefeated in conference, but dropped two at Sac State. So tonight, there will just be one remaining undefeated team in the conference. Let's get right to it as we start on a Friday night, and no one other than Jake Wong on the mound for GCU. Wong, the Friday night guy, getting his starts under the lights. You see him there warming up and getting ready to go. Jake, in his seventh start of the year, a 1.62 ERA, a record of 2 wins against 1 loss. In six starts, he has 39 innings, 23 hits, 9 runs, 7 earned. He's walked 11 and struck out 25. Opponents hitting .176 against Wong. Jake will be throwing to the backstop. Josh Meyer, who's come in and played extremely well for GCU, kind of taken over that role as the catcher for Grand Canyon University. Let's take a look at the defense behind Jake Wong tonight. We'll go left to right, starting in the outfield. In left field, Tyler Wyatt gets the start, number 5 out there. In center field, Thomas LaRouge. And in right field, the preseason WAC player of the year, Garrison Schwartz. Around the horn in the infield, third base to first. At third, Big Zach Malice. Mark Mumper at short. Austin Bull at second. Ian Evans at first base for GCU behind Jake Wong. For the Bears, Dean Larson will lead things off, the second baseman. Evan Johnson, the left fielder, bats second. Cole Maltese, the right fielder, bats third. Jack Pauley, the DH, bats fourth. Brett Minnick will bat fifth. The first pitch to Lawson on the outside corner for strike one. Nick Tanner, the center fielder, bats sixth. Alex Keel, the catcher, bats seventh. Matt Burkhart, the third baseman, bats eighth. And Tyler Yamaguchi, the shortstop, bats ninth. Lawson fouls that one back. We are underway here. At 7 o'clock, just a touch before 7 p.m. here on a beautiful night under the lights here at Brazel. You can see the beautiful sunset back over the left field wall. The 0-2 to Lawson up high. 1-2 to Dean Lawson, leading things off for this Bears squad that has won 3 games already in the WAC. They came out and swept Sac State, did it in dramatic fashion, some come-from-behind victories. Both these teams looking to stay undefeated and atop the conference leaderboards. The 1-2. Boy, ripped into the third base dugout. That is a weird angle to foul one off for a righty. Guys weren't ready for that one. Count stays at 1-2. Lawson enters the night, hitting .237, 1 homer and 6 RBI. The 1-2. Fouled off again, so a good at-bat for Dean Lawson. Well, Jake Wong, a record of 2-1 on the season, but it's been tough sledding for Jake Wong. Got his first win and his first outing on the 17th of February against Oklahoma State, picked up a second win March 5th up at St. Mary's, and has been no decision the last three. Got him to chase one. Can Meyer track it down in time? The throw down to first in time to get the strike him out, throw him out. One up, one down. Wong starts this off in nice fashion with the strikeout. Mentioned that Jake, in 39 innings, has 25 strikeouts. That's number 26. And you see that ball snapped off right on top of home plate, and Lawson, no chance to hold up. Evan Johnson at the dish now. Outside corner for the strike. Almost the exact same pitch that Wong started things off against Lawson. Johnson hitting .322. Chop foul. So once again, Jake Wong ahead in the count. No balls and 2 strikes. Johnson hitting .322. 4 homers and 20 RBI. This is a team that really likes to pound the ball. 21 homers for this Bears squad. The 0-2. Fouled back. Count stays no balls, and two strikes. If you peel back those numbers a bit, you'll see that the Bears hit 17 of those 21 in their first 13 games, only four homers in their last 10. That one chopped, almost looked like it skewed off his foot, but Malice, an easy play and an easy throw. Two up, two down. So Wong looking for a 1-2-3 inning here.
Now batting right fielder number four, Cole Maltese.
That'll bring up Cole Maltese. Maltese, the number three hole hitter. Redshirt junior right fielder. Maltese hitting 337, leads the team with six home runs and 15 RBI. Pitch in there for a strike. So Jake setting the tone early, starting every batter he's faced so far this inning out with a strike one. That one chop foul, 0-2. So every batter he's faced so far, he's been ahead in the count, no balls and two strikes. And Jake Wong having a tremendous year. We mentioned the 2-1 record, really just more tough luck losses through six good innings against San Francisco, seven at Pepperdine, and seven at Bakersfield, and no decisions in those outings. Wasted one, and the batter Maltese wouldn't chase it. But Jake currently leads the Western Athletic Conference in ERA. Earned run average coming into this one, just a buck 62. The 1-2. Swing and a miss, struck him out. That's what you like to see on a Friday night, get things going here at Brazel. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left on base. Wong strikes out two, and we go to the bottom of the first, no score with GCU coming up. Well, folks, you can get the best gear to show off your Lope pride. Just go to lopeshops.gcu.edu to find everything GCU, from the newest apparel to the coolest accessories. Use promo code GCUTV20 to get 20% off for being a GCU TV viewer. Let's paint the valley purple, folks. Lopes up. No scores. We go to the bottom of the first on the mound for the Bears from University of Northern Colorado, Aaron Hamilton. Hamilton, a 2-1 record, a 3.95 ERA, the redshirt junior right-hander. If we go over his numbers, this will be his eighth appearance, his sixth start of the year. In 27 and a third, Hamilton has given up 21 hits, 13 runs, 12 earned. He's walked 9 and struck out 27. Opponents hitting 219 against the Bears starter. Defensively for the Bears, behind home plate, Alex Keel. In the outfield, left to right, behind Hamilton. Evan Johnson in left, Nick Tanner in center. Cole Maltese in right. And on the infield, Matt Burkhardt, Tyler Yamaguchi at short, Dean Lawson at second, and Brett Minnick at first. Well, no surprises for GCU. Austin Bull is going to lead things off. The sophomore switch hitting second baseman, having a fantastic season as a leadoff man. Tom LaRouge will bat second, play center field. Ian Evans, the junior first baseman, bats third. Garrison Schwartz, the left hitting right fielder, bats fourth. Tyler Wyatt, the sophomore in left field, bats fifth. Zach Malice, the sophomore at third base, bats sixth. Quinn Cotton, the freshman, getting the start at DH and batting seventh. Josh Meyer, the redshirt junior behind home plate, bats eighth. And Mark Mumper, the shortstop, bats ninth. So Bull, LaRouge, Evans, Schwartz, Wyatt, Malice, Cotton, Meyer, and Mumper due up for GCU. Austin Bull hitting 379 on the year. No homers and seven RBI. First pitch in there for a strike. So Hamilton doing what Wong did and getting ahead of the first batter he faces. 0-1 the count to Bull. Hamilton working quickly up high. Like to see that on a Friday night, the aces of each staff just going to work, not wasting too much time dilly-dallying around. In the left, will it get down? Coming over, making the grab, the left fielder Evan Johnson. One up and one down for GCU. That'll bring up LaRouge. Boy, Bull, a fantastic job against Bakersfield, getting on base, leading off the first two games of that series, but unable to get on base here. So LaRouge will be up with one out, nobody on. Tom, another left-handed hitter, Bull, of course, a switch hitter hitting from the left side against the righty. Tom takes that one inside ball one. Tom hampered with a shoulder injury that he sustained last season in WAC play up at Seattle, diving for a ball out in center field, 1-1 the count. Had the little surgery over the summer and then came back here to play but was limited to just pinch hitting. Over the third baseman's head into left field for a base knock. Tom's thinking two. Doesn't slow down. Ball gets away from the left fielder. Now he's thinking three, but he will put on the brakes and head back to second base with a head first dive. So base hit single by LaRouge. He takes second base on the miscue out in left field by Evan Johnson. Now the Lopes have a man in scoring position. Boy, what a sweet swing. Just out in front of that, kept the hands in. Rocketed it over the third baseman, Matt Burkhart. He was thinking might get two, so he was motoring down to the first, taking the big turn. But once he saw that ball get by Johnson, he was off to the races. Ian Evans at the plate. Hopes with the chance to strike first here in the first, in the dirt. Blocked nicely by Keel. 1-0 to Ian Evans, the junior first baseman. Evans hitting 302. One homer and 14 RBI. Trails Garrison Schwartz for the team lead in RBI. The Rouge inching off with that lead. That one stayed away, 2-0. So Hamilton now in a bit of trouble here. Should have just been a base hit single with the man on first, but the error in left by Johnson allowed LaRouge to get to second base. Inside corner for a strike. Looked like it might have been up a bit as well, but Evans now good to go at the plate. 2-1 count. Steve Mattingly behind home plate. Carl Coles, your umpire at first, and Gary Gilman down at third. Check of the runner. Lawson trying to keep him close, and that one's rocketed foul over the crowd down there and off the first base side. 2-2 now to Ian Evans. Lopes 9-14, but 3-0 in conference play. Evans has started all 23 games this year, the 2-2. Just staying alive. Fouls it off the same direction. Boy, had a lot of folks running down there for the first foul ball. Hope he didn't catch anybody. Everybody looks to be okay over there. Just underway under the lights here at Brazel. Already a couple of finals in WAC play. The 2-2. Ground ball to short. Yamaguchi, the backhand, fires it across, and the runner LaRouge has to hold it second. So Yamaguchi, the sophomore shortstop with the play, and now the Lopes are going to need a two-out base knock, and they'll turn to Garrison Schwartz. Gary, the preseason WAC player of the year, starting off a bit slowly with the batting average, 244, two home runs, but leads the team with 16 RBI. Chance to make it 17 with the base knock here. Big gap in the shortstop area. Yamaguchi right behind home plate, and they're pitching him away too, which is odd. Pitch misses outside, ball one. Almost a bit of a shift on here. Look at the defensive alignment. You got the first baseman hugging the line, and the shortstop playing right behind second base. That one blocked nicely by Keel. So evidently the Bears, and they're scouting. Figure that Schwartz is a dead pull hitter here, but Hamilton pitching him away, almost going against the defensive alignment. The 2-0. Lopes trying to draw first blood here. That one, breaking ball inside, goes to 3-0. Well, it almost looks like Hamilton would be fine pitching around Garrison Schwartz to put him on first with the base open, but got to face the hot hitting Ty Wyatt on deck. And he walked him on four. So now the Lopes have runners at first and second. Wyatt coming up to the plate.
Tyler Wyatt
had trouble finding a spot to play. And you see Garrison Schwartz talking to Greg Bordas down there at first base. So Schwartz at first, and you got LaRouge down there at second. Wyatt now at the plate, though. Wyatt hitting 306 with one homer and four RBI, coming off a fantastic series against Bakersfield where he hit 600. Scored four runs and drove in one. So swinging a hot bat. That one framed nicely by Keel. Brought it right back in the top of the zone, and Mattingly called a strike one. Wyatt pegged Mr. Versatile last year. Played every position in the infield except catcher. Now he's moved out to the outfield, starting left field here today. Outside. I talked to Coach Stankiewicz prior to the game and said, does it matter to you? Are you going to try to get him in center, right, and behind the plate sometime this year? And he kind of looked at me like, we don't really worry about things like that. Trying to win ball games. I said, come on, man. The 1-1. Check of the runner. The pitch popped up. It stays in. Keel coming back with room. Makes the grab. Ooh, and then runs into the end of the bench there. Of course, it's the visiting bench, so no help from Ethan Ivanko down there closest to him. You know, you go over there to make the grab at your own risk. But Keel stayed with it, and Wyatt pops up. So no runs on one hit. There was one error and two left on base. We've completed one. No score here at Brazel. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
Learn the art of hospitality management at GCU, right in the heart of Phoenix, Arizona, a top tourism market bustling with opportunity for our hospitality students. Join the student team at GCU Hotel, delivering unmatched service plus amenities like the Oasis Pool, Fitness Center, and Canyon 49 Grill. Learn golf management at GCU Championship Golf Course, featuring over 7,200 yards of expansive tees and tree-lined fairways. Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Visit gcu.edu.
No score here at Brazel, just underway as we go to the second inning. Lopes got LaRouge down to second, but could not score him with just one out. And we go to the top of the second. Jack Pauley, Brett Minnick, and Nick Tanner do up, 4, 5, and 6 for the Bears. Two strikeouts in the first inning already for Jake Wong. And he looks to be on his game here as Lopes gets set for the second inning. Well, this is a big game, obviously, for GCU. They swept their first conference series of the season against Bakersfield. And that guy right there, Mark Mumper, playing some big innings in that ball game, defensively mainly. But, you know, Coach Stankiewicz earlier was saying, I really feel like Mark's hitting the ball really well. It's just they're not falling for him. He's had some good at-bats, so they expect that bat to come around too. But, boy, folks, if you've watched any of these games, if you watched them play down at U of A on Wednesday, I mean, Mark was making all kind of plays defensively out there. And you know, in the pregame interview with Coach Stankiewicz, he talked about the fact that it really allows him to move Bull back to a position he's a little more comfortable with at second base. First pitch, swing and a miss, and looked like Jack Pauley was going for the downs on that one. Mumper, a kid that just seemed like he needed some extra playing time. He's getting it here, the 0-1. Swing and a miss, 0-2. Jack Pauley, 386 on the year, four homers, 25 RBI. Gotta be careful with this kid. The 0-2, see if he wastes one. He does, outside. Pauley wouldn't chase it. Pauley, the DH, designated hitter in this ballgame. Pauley out of Overland Park, Kansas. Played at Western Nebraska Community College before coming to UNC. Chopper right side. Evans waits. Wong covers. One up, one down. Looked like Ian was going to charge that initially, but boy, that took a high hop off the turf, that first bounce. And Pauley retired, so Jake Wong is now retired. The first four batters that he's faced, and it'll be Brett Minnick, the junior first baseman. Minnick digs in it in 298 with two homers and 16 RBI. Down low, ball one, first batter of the ballgame that Wong has fallen behind after the first pitch. Wong Both of these teams, as we mentioned, swept their first conference opponents, the Lopes, a three-game sweep at home against Bakersfield. This Bears team, three-game sweep against Sac State at home. Missed outside, and now Wong having trouble finding the strike zone, 3-0 the count. That one in there for a strike. Three balls and one strike. Fouled off, and now Wong battles back. Three balls and two strikes to count. One out here in the top of the second. No score from Brazel. On the preseason polls, GCU was picked to finish fourth in the conference. Northern Colorado picked eighth in the conference. And he walks him. First walk of the ball game for Wong. First base runner for the Bears. So it's a bit of a shock to most folks that these are the two teams left standing as undefeated going into the ball game tonight. Utah Valley has already dropped two at home against Sac State, 9-1 and 12-4. So they're now 3-2 in conference play. Minnick on first. That'll bring up Nick Tanner. First pitch up high. Now Meyer's going to come out and have a word with his pitcher. Wong was just cruising. Got through the first four with no problems at all. Now some control problems, and it might just be something as simple as a little technical issue there. Wong kind of smiling with whatever Meyer and Mumper said to him. 1-0 count to Nick Tanner. Tanner, 228 on the year, one homer, 9 RBI. Left-handed hitting center fielder for the Bears. The 1-0. In there for a strike. I was about to call that one very quickly because it looked like a great pitch, but Steve Mattingly took his time making the strike call on that one. New Mexico State at Seattle. UTRGV at Bakersfield today as well. The 1-1. Swing and a miss late on that one, 1-2. And Chicago State's already fallen 10-6 at home against Eastern Michigan. The 1-2. Fouled off. Staying alive is Tanner. In the bottom of the fifth in Seattle, New Mexico State and Seattle tied at one apiece. New Mexico State in their first conference games. They were the one team that played non-conference opponents last weekend. Seattle, 1-2. They were picked to win the whole thing this year. 2-2. So if you look at the entire preseason coaches poll, Seattle picked to finish first, New Mexico State second, Sac State third, the Lopes fourth, Utah Valley fifth, Bakersfield sixth, UTRGV seventh, Northern Colorado eighth, and Chicago State ninth. Throw over, runner back. Minnick on the year, 0 for 2 in stolen bases. UTRGV at Bakersfield, no score in that one. As we mentioned, Sac State's already won twice at Utah Valley. The 2-2. In the air, LaRouge ranging over toward left. Going to reach up and make the grab. Right in front of the scoreboard there, cutting in front of Wyatt for out number two. That'll bring up the catcher, Alex Keel. You see LaRouge covering a lot of ground out there, Wyatt. They're backing him up just in case Tommy couldn't get to that one, but he definitely could. Good to see Tom out there in center field. You know, Preston Pavlik has started in center field this season, played the position very well, but then ran into a wall up at St. Mary's, making a fantastic catch. By all accounts, one of the best catches most folks have seen. Hurt his wrist, so he's been out ever since, and Tom able to come back in and play. First pitch to Keel, misses inside. Going to Quiggle, the freshman, played out there a few games, but once Tom was ready to go and could throw the ball effectively, they put him right back out there. And it's good to see him gliding around out there in center field covering a lot of grass. Keel, 262 on the year, no homers, 4 RBI. Late on that one. 1-1. Boy, on deck batter. Burkhart, nothing you can do there. Just hope it misses you. He decided to move away from the official on-deck circle. Get a better angle there with the batter up. Minnick down there at first. He walked, and now it's up to Keel to get a two-out base knock to keep this inning going, the 1-1. Boy, nice inside pitch low, just too far inside, 2-1. So for whatever reason, Wong has started to struggle here in the top of the second. Mowed through the Bears in the first with a couple of strikeouts. Got the first batter here in the second, and then the walk. And now behind the count, 2-1 with two outs. Ground ball down the third, backhanded by Malice. Long throw across, plenty of time, and that is your inning. So for the Bears in the second, no runs, no hits, no errors. One man left on base. Wong gets through it and heads back to the dugout. His Lopes coming up in the bottom of the second. No score here from Brazel. Well, folks, if you're on campus, check out GCBC for locally sourced coffee, tea, and treats. That's a Grand Canyon Beverage Company located in the Student Union, Roadrunner Apartments, and Canyon 49. GCBC, Grand Canyon Beverage Company. I have gotten a few Americanos there. Very tasty. Josh, GCBC? No, haven't been there yet? Josh is from the Pacific Northwest, though, so he knows coffee. But you don't drink coffee, do you? Yeah, very high standards up there. GCBC, if you're on campus, check it out. We go to the bottom of the second. No score here for the Lopes. It'll be Malice, Cotton, Meyer. If anybody can get aboard, Mark Bumper. And they'll try to flip that lineup. GCU had LaRouge on second base with one out in the first, but could not advance him any further. Andy Stankiewicz coaching down at third base. Greg Bordas at first. Stankiewicz in his sixth year for GCU. Record of 163, 129, and 1. 558 winning percentage as Malice digs in. So in his sixth year, Stankiewicz decides to go back and coach third base. First pitch, a strike to Zach Malice. Of course, he coached third base a number of years across town when he was an assistant coach and third base coach at ASU. The 0-1. Checked his swing, did he? They looked to see if he went around. He did. 0-2. So Malice behind in the count, hitting just 233 on the year. No homers, 11 RBI. Up high, and he wouldn't chase it. 1-2. Malice, a fantastic freshman season. He got an at-large selection to the preseason all-WAC team because of it. Fouled back. Had a nice summer as well, making that transition from first base to third base. Garrison Schwartz and Zach Malice, the only two Lopes on the preseason all-Western Athletic Conference team. Of course, Gary was the player of the year. Fouled back. So Malice now digging in, having a nice at-bat here against Aaron Hamilton, the starter for the Bears. In there, strike three, couldn't pull the trigger. Might have been fooled on that one because that looked right down the heart of the plate. First strike out of the ballgame for the Bears starter, Hamilton. First out of the inning. That'll bring up Quinn Cotton. Quinn Cotton in 238 in 15 ballgames, 42 at-bats, no homers, one RBI. This is his 10th start of the season. Right-handed hitting DH. First pitch in there for strike one to Cotton with one out, nobody on. Cotton, 5'11 freshman out of Parker, Colorado. Played his high school ball at Regis Jesuit. 1-1. Had a few Colorado kids on this squad for GCU. Down in the dirt. fouled off, slicing, going to get out of play and into the bullpen down there to the right. So Cotton will come back and do it all again. Beautiful night here at Brazel, about 63 degrees at first pitch. The 2-1, missed down low. 3-1 to Cotton. Should get down to about 60 degrees tonight. But 6-7 mile an hour wind when it kicks up out of the northwest, and Cotton takes the walk. So Lopes have a runner aboard, second walk of the ball game for the starter Hamilton, and Quinn Cotton down there with Josh Meyer coming to the plate. Cotton checking out the signs from Coach Stankiewicz down at third, having a little chat. Greg Bordas down there whispering in his ear. Cotton 1-for-2 in stolen bases. See if the Lopes try to get something going, but Meyer hitting 304 with no homers but 5 RBI. They have one extra base hit. That was a double. Meyer typically not a guy you're going to hit and run with, but you try to steal Cotton in a scoring position. Going after the first pitch and fouling it back. For Josh Meyer, just his 8th start of the season. Josh is getting the chance behind the dishes. Played very well. Really came alive in those 2 starts against Bakersfield. Throw over and Cotton dives back. Josh Meyer in that Bakersfield series, which the Lopes swept, played all 3 games, started 2, hit 571 with 4 hits, 3 runs, a double, 3 RBI. The 0-1. Another throw over, and Cotton dives back safely. Another head first dive, so. Looks like Quinn could take another couple of steps on that lead. Cotton obviously bothering Aaron Hamilton over there. An 0-1 count. You wouldn't imagine he'd be running at 0-1. Pitch to Meyer. Fouled off again. So the redshirt junior down on the count. No balls and 2 strikes. Josh had 276 in his freshman campaign in 2014. Almost a pitch out there. Well, high and away. 1-2 to Meyer. Josh had a homer and 25 RBI. Didn't play that well in 31 games in 2015. Then had the arm injury and missed all of last year. Back at it here. Playing well. The 1-2 throw over. Ooh, that went right on the base runner, but Cotton dives in safely. Meyer already matching his RBI total this year from the last year he played back in 2015. Just 8 games in. Another throw over. So far, the crowd being pretty nice to the pitcher, Hamilton. Usually, they start groaning and oohing and eyeing when the opposing pitcher throws over the first too many times. But we are a kinder, gentler ballpark here in Phoenix. The 1-2. Cotton not going. Ooh, swing and a miss on a high fastball. And Meyer knew he chased one there. So second strikeout of the inning for Hamilton. 2 down. Now bring up the shortstop, Mark Mumper. So the walk flips the lineup card. See if Mark Mumper can keep it going here. Mumper hitting .143 on the year. No homers, but 5 RBI. This is his 14th start of the year, but his 16th game of the year. Mumper, one of those Colorado kids out of Highlands Ranch. Squares to bunt, up high, ball 1. Dad Dave was a baseball coach for 30 years, scout for the White Sox, so baseball in the family. Dad played baseball and basketball at Western State in the late 70s, early 80s. A pie, 2-0. Throw over and the runner back. The Lopes were swept by Northern Colorado up in Greeley last year. In three games, it really felt like they should have either been in or won. Up high. Last year up there, the Lopes, even in one of those games, just kind of tell you how it went, had a 9-0 lead and just saw it evaporate. Ended up losing 10-9. In that game, Mumper had a three-run homer, and Lopes were just cruising, but hung a bunch of zeros on the board, and Northern Colorado reeled them back in and got the win, went on to sweep the series. Ball four, third walk of the ball game for Hamilton, and the Lopes have runners at first and second, top of the order coming up. So Mumper works the walk. That pushes Cotton down to second, and the top of the order is up in the form of Austin Bull. So both pitchers struggling to find the plate, struggling to find their control here in the second inning. Two outs here. And down low, in the dirt. Bull lined out to left field his first time up. Austin hitting 375 on the season. No homer, seven RBI. Let's have five extra base hits, four doubles and one triple. Bottom of the second, no score. The second inning in a row as that one misses 2-0. The Lopes have a runner at second base. LaRouge got there with one out in the first. The Lopes now have Cotton out there at second base with two outs in the second. And Bull ahead in the count, two balls and no strikes. See if he can turn on one here. 2-0. Hamilton checks and delivers. Boy, he was going for one there, but a nice fastball outside. Swing and a miss, two balls, one strike. Still a great hitter's count for Bull. This is, with Bull, it's not a bad count to put something on here, a hit and run, because, boy, he makes contact so well. We'll see what Coach Stankiewicz wants to do. Good speed out there, Cotton at second, Mumper at first, and they're not holding Mark on, so he's going to get a great jump. Minnick playing well behind him. The 2-1, runner's not going, fouled off left side. Count goes to two balls and two strikes. That one's going to get all the way out of play, and everybody quits giving chase, and Burkhart heads back to third. Cotton second, Mumper first, no score. We are in the bottom of the second. Each of these teams trying to remain the only undefeated in Western Athletic Conference play. Two, two to Bull. Outside 3-2. So now the runners will get a jump here with the full count. And you would think a gapper would easily score Mumper. Cotton will be able to come home on a base hit single, unless it's of the infield variety. The 3-2, there go the runners in the air to right. Hit well, but right at the right fielder, Cole Maltese. Settles himself and makes the grab, and that is the inning. Boy, Bull made good contact on that one, but right at the right fielder, Maltese. So for the Lopes, no runs on no hits. There were no errors and a couple of guys left on base. We have completed two. No score here at Brazel. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
Earning your RN to BSN degree online doesn't have to be without the college experience. Finding your purpose takes support from those around you. GCU's leadership offers over three decades of experience delivering our accredited RN to BSN program 100% online. Graduate in as few as 16 months, learning from full-time practicing nurse faculty in small classes. Integrate your education with your faith and Christian worldview.
Find your purpose online at Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
No score here as we go to the third inning. Hope's enjoying the brisk evening there in the dugout. Jake Wong back on the hill to start inning number three. He cruised through the first inning, did Wong. A couple of strikeouts, got him 1-2-3. Had a little bit of control problems in the second, but easily got out of that one. Now he's ready to go here in the third. Jake Wong has pitched very effectively this year. He's become the Friday night guy, and really no question about that, the ace of the staff. Just hasn't had the record to show for it. Record of 2 wins against 1 loss, but it easily could be a 4-1 or even a 5-1 record here for Jake Wong. And he'll face 8-9-1. Burkhart, Yamaguchi in the top of the order, Lawson. First pitch, missed somewhere, maybe outside. Ball one. Burkhart, the freshman third baseman, at the plate for the Bears. Checked his swing. They want to lock down to first, but the home plate umpire Mattingly doesn't even ask. 2-0 the count. One of the misnomers about that check down, they say the catcher wanted to check it first, but the home plate umpire has to ask the first base umpire. Shot to short. Mumper's got it. Gobbles it up. Fires it across for the first out. So Burkhart retired, and that, a routine ground ball, but with Mumper over there, pretty much anything left hit to the left side with Mumper and Malice, you expect to be hoovered up over there and chucked over to first for the out. So number 9 hitter, Tyler Yamaguchi, the sophomore shortstop. Yamaguchi hitting .230 on the year, 1 homer, 8 RBI. Ground ball right side, bull. Kind of a crazy hop there at the end, makes the play. So a couple of ground balls, and quickly 2 up, 2 down. Jake Wong disposes of the bottom 2 in the order. A lot of ground covered there by Bull. Easy play. Top of the order, Dean Lawson, a strikeout victim, is first and only at bat here in this ball game. Lawson, the junior second baseman. Lawson hitting .234 on the year, 1 homer. So have 6 RBI. Fouled off right side. Low and inside, 1-1, the count. Jake Wong, this is his second appearance versus Northern Colorado. His first start. He has 1 relief appearance, and it didn't go well. 2 1/3 and a 15.43 ERA. The 1-1. Fouled off, late on it again. 1-2 to Dean Lawson, the leadoff man for the Bears. We're in the top of the third. No score here from Brazel. Well, they qualified the pitchers, and it's based on at least 1 inning pitched per team game. And Jake is just 1 of 64 qualifying pitchers in all of D1 baseball with an ERA of 1.65 or less. Almost hit him, did hit him. So Lawson on base with a hit by pitch, and the Lopes like to pitch inside. We saw, gosh, what do we see, 4 or 5 hit batters in that Bakersfield series? First one here in this one, and Lawson aboard with 2 outs. That'll bring up Evan Johnson. Johnson ground out to third. His first at bat back in the first inning. And misses 1-0. I was going by memory. I said 5 or 6 hit batters. Actually 7 hit batters in that Bakersfield series. Was close. Evan Johnson hitting 318, 4 homers, 20 RBI. Number two hole hitter here with Lawson on first. The pitch up high. 2-0, and now Wong starting to have a little control problems. Two quick outs to Burkhart and Yamaguchi. Ground balls to short and second, respectively. Now in a bit of a jam here. 2-0 count to a heavy hitter here. Already four home runs. 12 extra base hits. Eight doubles on the season already for Johnson. That one's, man, that one missed. Boy. Home plate umpire Steve Mattingly pinching the zone here a bit early on. And Jake, you could tell he wanted that one. Walked back behind the mound a bit. Taking a big, deep breath out there. Three-oh pitch in there for a strike. 3-1. Lawson takes his lead. Throw over. Lawson 6 of 8 in stolen bases this season, so he is a threat to get rolling here with the 3-1 count. Not going, the pitch in the air, hit pretty well. Deep right, Schwartz going back at the warning track, makes the grab for the inning. Boy, that one given a ride by a guy who's already got four home runs, but Gary tracks it down in right to end the inning. No runs on no hits, there were no errors, and a man left on base. We go to the bottom of the third, no score, LaRouge, Evans, and Schwartz coming up for GCU. Support your fellow classmates and entrepreneurs in this year's Canyon Challenge. The finalists will be presenting their business plans to win a share of $15,000 in total prizes. You can cheer on your favorite business on April 13th at GCU Arena or watch it live here on GCU TV. That's the Canyon Challenge. I really want to be a judge in that. I have no credentials to be said judge other than I buy stuff. So if anybody at GCU TV can make that happen, I'm talking to you, Barry Butel, get me on there as a judge. I think I'd be a really good judge. People would really like me. No score here as we go to the bottom of the third. Two, three, and four, LaRouge, Evans, and Schwartz do up. And a loose group down there in the dugout. Everybody in the dugout right now, typically when we get to the fifth inning, the bullpen, all the relief pitchers will run down to the bullpen. That dugout will thin out a little bit. Pitch misses outside, ball one to Tom LaRouge. Singled, went to second on an error by the left fielder, and then was stranded there in the first inning. 2-0. Well, both pitchers pitched, well, I should say Wong in the first inning, but they both struggled with their control. 3-0, and sometimes it's the control of the pitchers. It does seem like Mattingly's got a pretty tight strike zone, too. So he's not helping him out at all. And the 3-0. That one in there for a strike. Three balls and one strike to count. Now to Tom LaRouge. LaRouge hitting 340 and 571 when he leads off. He's doing it here. Swing and a miss. Boy, Tom was going for the downs on that one. Going for his second home run of the season and just came up empty. Full count now to the Lopes leadoff batter here in the third. Little flare in the left. Johnson coming over, makes the grab for the first out of the inning. Well, not the at-bat you're looking for when you get up 3-0 in the count. But Hamilton battles back, gets his man. So one out, Ian Evans at the plate. Big swing and a miss on that one. Ian Evans down the count. No balls and one strike. Evans ground out to short. His only plate appearance thus far in this ballgame. Hitting 299. The average is just dipped under 300. 1-1 to Evans. Evans, the junior out of Covina, California, came over from Gateway College. The 1-1. fouled back. Like Devins, obviously, brought him over here to play ball, and he is not disappointed thus far. Solidified that first base role, and it's not given away since opening day. The 1-2. Up the middle, will he get through? Lawson on a dive, the throw, in time to get his man. Slick play by the second baseman, Dean Lawson, robbing Ian Evans, of a base hit. Well, once that one got past the pitcher, it looked like Evans might have a shot to get it through, but a lot of ground for Lawson to cover. He did just that. Gary Schwartz at the plate now with two outs, nobody on, no score here in the third. Ball one. Schwartz reached on a walk his last time up. So this is second plate appearance for Garrison Schwartz. 1-0. Little flare to left. Johnson coming in. Going out is Burkhart. The dive. Can't make the catch. The ball gets away. Gary's trying to switch it to two, and he gets it. Throw gets away, but Schwartz is going to head back to second base with a double. Good hustle by Garrison Schwartz on that one. After the dive by Johnson, you see him just missing. Ball kind of got away, but it right underneath him, and had a chance to get Schwartz with a good throw. Might have got him at second base. Unable to do so. So Gary down there at second. So once again, Lopes got a man on second with a couple of outs. They've had a man on second with two outs in the first two innings and done nothing with it. So see if Tyler Wyatt can do something. Goes after the first pitch and fouls it off. Wyatt popped out in foul territory to the catcher, Keel, back in the first inning. Wyatt hitting an even 300 on the year. Hitting 286 with runners in scoring position. Popped him up again. Keel coming back. Burkhart coming over. Keel. Oh, and it falls in between them. Not a lot of communication down there, it did not look like, between Keel, the junior, and Burkhart, the freshman. Cannot make the grab, and that just falls right in between him. And Wyatt, see if he can make him pay for that defensive miscue. Well, you'd like to see, if you're a coach, you'd like to see the third baseman just call that all the way, hustle in and make that grab. It was a high pop foul, so it might have got lost in their lights by Burkhart, but he never looked like he was going to take control of that situation. That is a tough play for the catcher to make. Third baseman can come in on the ball. I think bending back toward the infield away from the catcher, very difficult. 0-2 count to Wyatt. Two outs, man on second. Fouled off again. But Gary, of course, going on contact with two outs. Should score easily on a base hit. Wyatt looking for his fifth RBI of the season. The 0-2. Oh, strike three called. Woof. I have yet to figure out the strike zone for Steve Mattingly. That one looked to be well outside, but Wyatt called out with strike three. No runs, one hit. There were no errors, and a man left on base. We've completed three. No score here at Brazel. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
Time. Time never stops, never slows down. We spend time on the things we love and the people who need us. The time we spend is precious. And before we know it, it's gone. But every end has the promise of a new beginning. It's time to create a better future. A new beginning awaits. Seize it. GCU's online degree program puts you first, so you can make the most of your time. Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University.
Beautiful night here at Brazel, about 60 degrees, a light breeze out of the northwest, and no score here as we go to the fourth inning. Jake Wong back on the hill. No runs, no hits, one error, and two left on for Northern Colorado. No runs, two hits, no errors, and five left on for GCU. That's the guy they left on to end the last inning. Garrison Schwartz had a two-out double, but Wyatt struck out looking on a pitch that by our estimation, was at least, I don't know, 8 to 18 inches off the plate. But Steve Mattingly, who we have yet to figure out his zone there behind home plate, called it strike three, and Wyatt was extinguished. Maltese, Paulie, and Minnick. 3-4 and 5 due up. Maltese, a strikeout victim, swinging. Only saw three pitches, I believe, from Jake Wong. Wong struck out two in that first inning, is yet to strike out another bear hitter. That one foul tipped. Strike one to Cole Maltese. Maltese, the redshirt junior right fielder for these Bears. Late swing, just chopped a foul, 0-2. Sac State has already beaten Utah Valley twice. Chicago State lost at home to Eastern Michigan. In the bottom of the fifth, 1-1, New Mexico State and Seattle. No score, UTRGV in Bakersfield. One ball, two strike, the count to Maltese. That one in the dirt. 2-2. Well, now that I've refreshed things here, 6-2, New Mexico State knocks off Seattle. Seattle picked to win this thing in the Western Athletic Conference. Tough sledding so far. Line drive, right at Bull for the out. Hit well. Austin Bull able to make the grab. That'll bring up Jack Pauley. So Maltese, all you can do is just kind of take that helmet off, wander back, and commiserate with your fellow teammates over there that you got good wood on the ball, but aluminum in this case, but you couldn't get it to fall. Missed outside, ball one to Jack Pauley, the DH. Pauley, a ground out to first his last time up. In the air to left, Wyatt coming over. Still going back at the base of the wall, reaches up, doesn't make the grab. Well, that ball was bending around out there, and Wyatt couldn't come up with it. So a one-out double there for Pauley. At the base, backing into the wall, looks like he came right off the glove. Wyatt, a chance to make that grab, couldn't come up with it. And I'm bringing up Brett Minnick with a man in scoring position. First Bears base runner to reach second base in this ball game. Minnick walked his first time up against Jake Wong, hitting 298 on the year. That's the kind of power. Is that what misses down low? What we talked to you about with this Bears squad with 21 home runs on the season. That one really didn't look like he got all of it. Speaking about Paulie, but boy, that thing just kept going and going and going. I think it took Tyler Wyatt a little by surprise with how much carry was on that ball with that swing that Paulie put on it. Late swing and a miss, 1-1. Wong checks to the runner. Pauley not going anywhere. Backhanded. Nice stab there from Meyer to keep that from going to the backstop. And now Josh is going to come out and have a word with his pitcher. Wong has been struggling and scuffling ever since that first inning when he got him 1-2-3. So New Mexico State now 1-0 in conference play. Bakersfield up 6-2 on UTRGV, trying to get their first win in conference. And Seattle now 1-4 in the conference. 2-1. Foul tipped into the mitt, 2-2. Seattle, surprising thing, all these home games for them, they lost to Chicago State in that series and have lost New Mexico State here. 3-2 the count now to Minnick with a man on second and just one out here in the fourth inning. The 3-2. Fouled off. Count stays 3-2. In that ball game up in Bellevue, Washington, it was a 1-1 ball game, and New Mexico State scored 2 in the 7th and 3 in the 8th and got the victory 6-2. Kyle Bradish goes to perfect 4-0 on the season. Prezina got the loss. He goes to 3-1. Now Wong steps out and wants to see the signs again. Breaking pitch in there, strike three called. Dropped it right in there. First strikeout for Wong since he K'd Maltese back in the first inning. And you watch this beauty right there. Just what a fantastic breaking pitch in there for strike three. Third strike out of the ballgame for Wong, and now he's one out away from getting himself out of this jam. He's got to go through Nick Tanner. Tanner flew out to center his first at bat against Jake. Ground ball to second. This should be it. Bull comes up with it, fires the first, and that's the inning. So Wong pitches around the one-out double by Pauly. Gets a strikeout and then a ground out. No runs on one hit. There were no errors. And a man left on base. We go to the bottom of the fourth. No score here from Brazel with Malice, Cotton, and Meyer coming up for GCU. Well, check out companies on campus next week in the Student Union. Network with different companies, learn about jobs and internships, maybe even land a job. For more information, contact careerservices@gcu.edu, or you can follow them on Facebook for future opportunities at facebook.com/GCU Career Services. So if you don't win the Canyon Challenge on April 13th and get some money to start your own business, go get a job. Companies on campus next week in the Student Union. Or you can do both. No score here as we go to the bottom of the fourth. Malice, Cotton, and Meyer do up, and both teams have had their chances. No runs, one hit, one error, and three left on for Northern Colorado, no runs, two hits, no errors, and five left on for GCU. That'll bring up Malice. Zach struck out looking in the second on a 1-2 count. Beautiful night here. We see folks out there in that parking structure many times during the day. They're in that level just from the top, so they're shielded by the sun. Few of them out there now on this one. Malice bunting on the first pitch. They had the shift on, and did it hit the bag? Hits the bag. Fair ball. Base hit. Zach Malice. Well, they had a shift on. The Bears doing that shift against Garrison Schwartz a bit. But nobody down there at third. They just bunted it, and it rolled and hit the bag, and it's a fair ball. Had the bag been 91 feet, it would have been a foul ball and rolled right by it. So Malice on with the base hit single on the bunt. Quinn Cotton at the plate. Chopper up the middle. Is he going to get through? It does. Past the dive of Lawson, and Lopes are in business. A bunt single and a base hit right back up the box for Cotton. You got runners at first and second. Nobody out. And bring up Josh Meyer. Might ask Meyer to drop a bunt down here, but then you got Mumper and the top of the order. Pretty good speed out there with Malice and Cotton. Good to see Quinn Cotton jump on that one, take it right back up the box. That is his 11th hit of the season. Meyer strikeout victim his last time up against Aaron Hamilton. Bunting, up high, ball one. So Coach Stankiewicz wanting to move these runners both into scoring position. Lopes have had a runner, at least one runner in scoring position every inning so far, but have yet to advance a man past second base. Bears are expecting bunt outside 2-0. Well, a walk to load the bases would be just fine too. Meyer hitting 292 on the year. In there for a strike, 2-1. Meyer, no sacrifice bunts this season. Minnick in on the grass at first. Burkhart in the bunt, puts it down. Minnick's got it. One plays to first. They get the out. Nice bunt there by Meyer. You got runners at second and third now for Mark Mumper. So Josh Meyer gets the job done. He trots back to the dugout to get his congratulations from the boys. Bat boy struggling a bit to pick up that bat, but recovers and hustles back. Gets the high five from Preston Pavlik over there. So Mumper at the plate to walk his last time up. Is only at bat here. Malice at third, Cotton at second. First pitch to Mumper up around the eyes, ball one. Big gap in left center field. Breaking pitch missed low and away. Ball two. So Mumper, ahead in the count, can be quite selective here, hitting 143 on the year. But as you heard, if you listened to the pregame interview with Coach Stankiewicz, he thinks Mark's been putting some good swings on the ball, just hasn't been fortunate with the way they've been bouncing. We'll see if Mark can put one in play. There's Coach down there talking to Zach Malice. Don't want to run into anything on a line drive here. Cotton down at second, Malice at first, Mumper at the plate. No score here. We're in the fourth. Lopes with a great chance here with just one out. The 2-0. 2-1. Mumper checking with Steve Mattingly about where that ball was. Mumper, a chatty kid, always says, "Hey, how's it going?" Has a couple words to say to you when you walk by. Chatting up the home plate umpire there. The 2-1. Fouls it off. 2-2. So Hamilton battling back nicely. Mumper just staying alive here now. Two ball, two strike count. First game of a three-game set here. Tomorrow at 2. And then Sunday at noon. We'll get you out of here tomorrow in time to catch the majority of the first game of the Final Four. Definitely for the second game. The 2-2. Swing and a miss on a high fastball. Mumper unhappy with himself that he chased that one. It would have been ball three, and he knows it. Fourth strikeout of the ball game for Hamilton, and that'll be the top of the order. And Lopes are going to have to get a two-out base knock here. Bull, a line out to left and a line out to right. Hit it very well the last time, and if you were here for batting practice, Austin Bull hit a couple out of the ballpark. See if he can put a swing on one here. Big, big gap down the right field line. Looks like they're going to be pitching him away. Now Keel looking into the dugout to get the sign. how they want to pitch Austin Bull. Bull hitting 371 on the year. Five extra base hits. That's four doubles and one triple. Breaking pitch in there for strike one. Well, typically it's that third time through the lineup that gives a starting pitcher a bit of a challenge. You ideally want that to not happen until the sixth or seventh inning or so. We're in the fourth, and this is now the third time through the lineup. See if Bull has figured Hamilton out. In the dirt, blocked nicely by Keel, saved a run. 1-1. Now Keel's going to wants to run out and have a chat with his pitcher. Not sure if he was crossed up on that one or wanted a different location, but now they're going to try to get on the same page here with two outs and runners in scoring position for GCU. Hamilton coming off a win in that series against the Hornets. First time UNC has ever swept Sac State. In the dirt, blocked again by Keel. 2-1, so good count here for Bull. Fouled. Right back. 2-2 to Austin Bull. LaRouge on deck. No score here. Bottom of the fourth. Austin Bull battling into reigning MAC Player of the Week. Shot up the middle, base hit. Malice scores easily. Cotton going to come around. The throw, not cut off. Cotton scores. Bull takes second. So a two RBI single for Austin Bull. Brings home Malice and Cotton with the first two runs of the ball game. And then Bull takes second on the throw. On a 2-2 count, no less. Great piece of hitting by Bull. Down in the zone and just rifled it into center field. And that throw from the center fielder, Tanner, took forever to get to home plate and missed the cutoff man by about 10 feet. So Bull easily able to take second. See, Tanner, when he made that throw, realized he might have missed his man. So the Lopes draw first blood. 2-0 GCU. And that's always fun when you knock in a couple runs, when you get to run over and talk to your head coach. You can see the pitching coach, R.D. Spees, out there in his sixth season having a chat with his pitcher and catcher. And it wasn't a horrible pitch. It was low in the zone, but, boy, Bull was just all over it. Those lefties love pitches low in the zone. Now Andy having a chat with Bull before he heads back out to second base. So Coach Stankiewicz's team gets a 2-0 lead on a two-out base knock by Austin Bull to drive in two. And LaRouge trying to get a base hit and drive in another run. He had a base hit in the first inning and then flew out to left in the third. Outside corner for a strike. LaRouge had that liner into left and then was misplayed by Johnson down there, allowing him to get to second base. Hamilton trying to get out of this jam with just those two runs across. Fouled back our direction. 1-1. Might have that wrong. I think it's 0-2. Is it 0-2? Yeah, 0-2. Now Mattingly looked down at his clicker and didn't say anything, so. Into left. That's going to get down. Bull on his horse. Misplayed again in left field. Bull scores easily. LaRouge cruises into second base. So once again, almost the exact same placement as in the first inning, and almost the exact same result. A base hit single, an error by the left fielder Johnson allows LaRouge to move into second, but the difference, that base hit brings in a run. So credit Tom LaRouge with an RBI. Boy, he was turning first hard and kind of looked up and saw that ball kick away and easily cruised in, and that'll bring up Ian Evans now with a man on second and two outs. The top of the order doing it again for GCU as LaRouge brings home Bull to make it a 3-0 ball game. And that's why you always hit your cutoff man, guys. Nick Tanner threw that right over the cutoff man's head, allowed Bull to take second, and he scores there. Had he not done that, it'd be runners at second and third more than likely. 1-1 the count. Ian Evans ground out to short and a ground out to second. In the dirt, Keel blocked it. A throw down to second behind LaRouge, but Tom back in time. 2-1 count. Well, LaRouge played that nicely, extending that lead on the ball in the dirt. Able to get back, though, in time before the throw down to second. High and away, 3-1 now with Garrison Schwartz on deck. Evans now can wait for one he wants. That could sit on a fastball here, and if he doesn't get it, be content with a 3-2 count. Action now in the pen for the Bears. Got a right-hander down there throwing, trying to get heated up here quickly. A 3-1, up high, and he walked him. So the walk to Evans. Runners at first and second. That'll bring up Garrison Schwartz. Schwartz walked his first time up against Hamilton and doubled down the left field line in the third. A double here would produce a couple more runs. Evans with good speed down there at first, and LaRouge with great speed at second. Jacob Howard, the senior righty, warming up in the pen for the Bears. Hamilton just trying to get out of this one. Up high, 1-0. And that's been the problem always with pitching, but here in this ball game, you get behind hitters, it leads to bad things. You got to make pitches and put pitches in there with bad counts, and good hitters know what to do with it. The 1-0, fouled back, 1-1. Boy, Gary was on top of that one. Actually under it a bit, but he was on it. Nice break pitch in there, it looked like. 1-2 the count now to Garrison Schwartz. Might be Hamilton's last batter here as Howard getting warmed up down in the bullpen. In the air, hit pretty well to center. Going back, just in front of the track. Making the grab is Tanner. Well, Gary gave it a ride, but not quite far enough. However, in the inning, three runs come across on four base hits. There was one error and a couple of guys left on base. We've completed 4-3-0 GCU. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
I'm Dominique. I'm a student here at Grand Canyon University studying hospitality management. My hospitality courses here are giving me a high-quality education from professors that I know have been successful. Being able to work while I'm in school has enriched my college experience. I feel like I know where I'm going and what I want to do. When they say find your purpose, they mean it.
Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
Three nothing GCU as we go to the top of the fifth. It'll be the bottom third of the order for the Bears, Keel, Burkhart, and Yamaguchi. Austin Bull, the man there fielding the ground ball in your picture. The big two-out base knock that drove in two. He then came around to score in front of the single by Tom LaRouge. So the top two in the order getting the job done. The top two in the order playing up the middle as well. Jacob Howard continues to warm down there, number 25. So that would tell me that he's ready to go and might be coming in this ball game. They might run Hamilton out there. You hate to get into your bullpen early. But be a very short leash if Hamilton goes out there again. First pitch down low in the dirt to Keel. Keel ground out the third. He's only up out of the ball game against Wong. Well, now Jake's just got to bear down and get the loops back in the dugout quickly. The 1-0. Fastball outside corner, 1-1. Jake has struggled a bit here in this ball game with his control after that dominant first inning. Two and one. Three and one. Well, Keel hitting 258 on the year. No homers. Four RBI. Ground ball to second. Easy play for Bull. One up and one down. Well, not the swing you're looking for on a 3-1 count by Keel, but does the Lopes a favor on the ground out to the right side. That'll bring up Matt Burkhart. Burkhart ground out to the shortstop his last time up. Hitting a .190 on the year with no homers and two RBI in there for strike one. Strike two. So Wong quickly ahead in the count. Maybe get himself going here with a couple of nice pitches. Breaking pitch, chopper to short. Mumper starts in, retreats, corrals it, and fires over to first for the out. Second time that Burkhart has been retired by Mark Mumper out there at shortstop. And that'll bring up Tyler Yamaguchi, the shortstop for the Bears. GCU softball squad playing on campus as well. Lost the first one today, 8-2 against Seattle. That one in there for a strike. Playing again right now in the second game of the doubleheader, and we'll play tomorrow at 7:30. Oh, I'm sorry, tomorrow at 5. Was looking at that wrong. Chop foul. No balls and two strikes. So game three of that three-game series is at 5 p.m. on the WAC Digital Network. The 0-2. Strike three, fouls it into the mitt. That is the fourth strikeout of the ball game for Wong in a 1-2-3 inning. First 1-2-3 inning for Jake Wong since he got him 1-2-3 in the first. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left on base. That's exactly how you want to do it after you drop a three spot on the board. 3-0 GCU as we go to the bottom of the fifth. Get the best gear to show off your Lope pride. Go to lopeshops.gcu.edu to find everything GCU, from the newest apparel to the coolest accessories. Use promo code GCUTV to get 20% off for being a GCUTV viewer. Let's paint the valley purple. Lopes up. New pitcher under the light of the moon and also under the light of the lights here at Brazel. Number 25, we saw him rushing to get ready. But the starter, Hamilton, got out of the inning with just three runs across. So Jacob Howard The 6'3" senior out of Puyallup, Washington, will get a chance to start an inning clean here as he comes on in relief of Aaron Hamilton. Lopes up 3-0 in this one. Hamilton's night is done. 4 innings, 6 hits, 3 runs. They were all earned. He walked 4 and struck out 4, faced 22 batters, threw 89 pitches, 51, 4 strikes. So Howard, your new pitcher here, will get you his numbers. Jacob Howard, a 3.63 ERA, a record of 3-0. This is his 10th appearance. In 22 and a third, Howard has given up 24 hits, 9 runs. They were all earned. He's walked 10 and struck out 14, oppositioning 293 against Howard. And it'll be Wyatt Mallison Cotton. Wyatt struck out looking in the third, popped out to the catcher in the first. So he will be the first man to greet Jacob Howard. Howard trying to get comfortable out there on the hill. Now he's ready to go. Showing bunt up high. Lopes in 8 to the plate last inning, scoring those 3 runs. Did it with 2 outs. Ooh, nice pitch. It looks like just missed outside 2-0. We'll take it, right? Howard's wondering about the strike zone now, just coming in. Well outside, 3-0. Lopes looking to pile on here and become the only undefeated team in WAC play this season. He walked him. So Howard promptly comes in and puts the first man he sees on base. That'll bring up Zach Malice and Wyatt down there at first. So Wyatt aboard for the first time in the ballgame. Wyatt 0 for 1 in stolen bases. He saw the signs from Stankiewicz and he leaned back and had a chat with Greg Bordes. Malice at the plate now. Malice struck out looking in the second. Had a bunt single to lead off the fourth and came around to score the first run of the ball game. Didn't offer outside ball one and low. Well, when Malice came up in the fourth, he saw that they had the shift on with the third baseman Burkhart shifted over in the shortstop area. He just reached out the first pitch and bunted it down the third base line. It rolled, looked like it was going foul, but gathered some momentum and hit the bag for a bunt single. Popped up behind the plate. One and one. The 1-1. Off speed pitch. Came back over the plate. 1-2 the count. We'll be back out here at Brazel tomorrow at 2. And game will be on GCU TV. We're on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network tonight. You can catch that game at GCU TV tomorrow, too. Ripped by Malice. Pretty deep. Going back at the track. Now coming in a bit as the ball hung up there in the air. Making the catch. Cole Maltese, the right fielder. Well, boy, we were watching batting practice as Malice thought he hit that one pretty good heading back to the dugout. I was watching batting practice down there in the dugout a little bit and talking to Gabe Borland, the strength performance coach, and we were watching Colorado, Northern Colorado hit, and they were hitting some bombs, but they were just dying out there in left field. And he said, man, the ball's really not traveling much tonight. And surely didn't on that hit by Malice. Quinn Cotton at the plate. Cotton 1-for-1, a walk and a single and a run scored. Throw over and Wyatt dives back. Well, at the bottom part of the order, Andy Stankiewicz might try something over here with Tyler Wyatt. Cotton been seeing the ball well this game. He walked in the second, then he took the first pitch up the middle for a base hit in the fourth. Wyatt not going anywhere, but Cotton going after the first pitch and fouls it off. 0-1 the count. We're in the bottom of the fifth, 3-0 GCU. Cotton in 255 on the year. No homers. Does have one RBI. Couple of extra base hits. One double and one triple. Wyatt takes his lead. Howard's pitch. Not going to inside. Almost clipped him. Did not. 1-1. Josh Meyer on deck. Josh is 0-for-1. Had a sacrifice bunt and a strikeout. Throw over, and Wyatt scrambles back with the head first slide. Top of the ninth in Bakersfield, and the Roadrunners leading the Vaqueros 6-3. 1-1. Pitch from Howard outside, 2-1. Now a pretty good count if the Lopes want to get something going here. Cotton looking down, getting the signs from Coach Stankiewicz. One pitch. There goes the runner. Hit to the right side. Beautifully executed hit and run. Into right field. Wyatt on his horse is going to go first to third. And there's Quinn Cotton with the second base hit of the ball game down there at first. Well, Coach Stankiewicz put on the hit and run. Wyatt broke with the pitch. And Cotton just shot it to the right side as he's supposed to do. Into right field for a base hit. So now the Lopes runners at the corners with Josh Meyer at the plate. Boy, that is a pretty scene when you execute the hit and run to perfection. Now Meyer a chance to do some damage. The Lopes already hung a crooked number on the board in the fourth with that three-run bottom of the fourth. Give themselves some breathing distance here. Well, the Vaqueros trying to come back with two outs. They've already got one run across and runners on. It's 6-4 Roadrunners in the top of the ninth. Cotton takes his lead. Howard's first pitch to Meyer. Breaking pitch in there for a strike. Howard came into the ball game in this inning. Walked the first man. That was Wyatt. Got a fly out to right by Mallett. Then a base hit single on the hit and run. Runners at the corners. Fake to third and a look to first. Pickoff that rarely works. Yo, one. Little flare fouled off and hit the screen above the Bears dugout. 0-2 on Josh Meyer. Meyer in 292 on the year. No homers. Does have five RBI. Could pick up another one here with the base knock. Yo, two. Ground ball. See if they can turn two. To second for one. Back to first. Not in time, and the run scores. Well, Meyer hustling down the line. A good call down there by the first base umpire. Carl Coles, who was all over that. Second out on the force play. That's a 4-0 GCU lead now. As Tyler Wyatt comes in to score. So give Josh Meyer an RBI on the fielder's choice. 4-0 GCU. Quinn Cotton, the second out of the inning on the 6-4. And it looked like Yamaguchi took a little bit of time as Mumford digs in on that transfer over to second. And Lawson unable to make the turn. One oh count to Mumper. Mumper walked his first time up back in the second and struck out in the fourth. Swing and a miss. 0-2 the count to Mumper. Steve Mattingly, the home plate umpire, making sure the coaches know the signs, but not showing us up here. Bumper down the count, no balls, two strikes, two outs. Meyer at first. Fouled off right side. Count stays at 0-2. Lopes got three in the fourth. They've tacked on another one here in the fifth. And did it with two out base hits in the fourth and then a one-out ground ball. Bears tried to turn two, unable to do so, and Wyatt comes in to score. Swing and miss. Mumper strikes out for the second time in the ballgame, second time in as many innings. But the Lopes push another run across. Jacob Howard came in last inning, gave up a run, walked the first man he faced. That was Tyler Wyatt, and Wyatt came around to score. Nip for strike one. The 0-1, and then for strike two on the outside corner. So Howard a little bit better with this leadoff man than in the last. 0-2 to Bull.
Hello, Phoenix. This is Jerry Colangelo from...
Lopes after this one, this series, eight of their next nine on the road. They come home in the midst of a couple road games to face Arizona on April 11th here at Brazel. Then not back to Brazel till the 21st. Up high, 1-2. GCU would obviously love nothing more than get a couple W's here at home before heading out on the road. Liner over the third baseman's head into left field for a second base hit of the ballgame for Austin Bull. Just a little too high for Burkhart. Just kept floating, floating, floating. That'll bring up LaRouge with a leadoff man aboard. Austin Bull down at first. LaRouge 2-for-3, a couple of base hit singles. The last base hit drove in Austin Bull back in the fourth. See if the Lopes want to get anything going here to apply some pressure. Bull, a good lead, not going. Bunted by LaRouge, bunted foul. Tom hitting 346 on the year. One homer, seven RBI. Got that one home run against Bakersfield. Took a big cut at that one up high. 0-2. Four nothing GCU. The Lopes, four runs, eight hits, no errors, eight left on. Northern Colorado, no runs, one hit, two errors, and three left on. Up high, 1-2. That home run by LaRouge. Happened a week ago on the Friday night ball game in the sixth inning. After Bakersfield had taken a 2-0 lead, LaRouge hit a two-run shot to tie it up in the sixth. Throw over, ooh, almost got him at first base. That was a little too close for comfort there. The way Minnick came off the bag, thought he had him. And Bull just hops up and says, yeah, that's a good lead. Just the right amount. Just got back. Not quite as big a lead. Throw over. Got back easily that time. Bull 0-for-4 in stolen base attempts, or in stolen bases this season. GCU as a team's 9 of 23. That one misses down low, 2-2. So not a huge base-stealing squad here, GCU. Two-two count to LaRouge. Nobody out here.
Time. Time never stops.
GCU looking to win there. Fifth in a row at home. There goes the runner. Check swing and no throw as that was a breaking pitch. Might have crossed him up inside. So Bull has his first stolen base of the year. Now running in scoring position with a 3-2 count. ECU looking to be the only undefeated team in Western Athletic Conference play. The 3-2. Chopper right side. That's going to at least move the runner. Tough play. The pitch, you nicely done over there by Minnick and Howard with the speedy runner to retire LaRouge. But that brings Bull down to third. So Tom does the right thing. Grounds out to the right side. 3-1 on the putout. And that brings up Ian Evans. And I'll just say it again, if you first time you've ever heard me broadcast a game, I feel like that should be a sacrifice and not count against Tom LaRouge because he moved the runner over. If he had a bunted that and squared around, it would be a sacrifice, right? Yeah, sack chop, SC. Evans up there. Josh Hauser and I just created that one, sack chop. So don't count that against his batting average. Can we make that happen? Just change the rules of baseball? No? Yeah, probably not. Evans walked his last time up, a couple of ground outs before that. So he's 0 for 2 in the ballgame. 1-0 count to Ian. In the air to center. That should be deep enough. Tanner makes the grab. Bull tags, hustles home, and the sack fly gets the runner in. 5-0 GCU. Well, Lopes manufacturing a run there. High fives all around for Bull and Evans. As Evans collects another RBI, that brings up Garrison Schwartz. Schwartz leads the team with 16 RBI, but Evans now with 15. Missed inside, ball one. 1-for-2 for Gary. He walked in the first, doubled in the third, and flew out to center in the fourth. Bull with the base hit single to stolen base. The ground out to the right side moved him to third and the sack fly. Gary hitting 250. Two homers, 16 RBI. The 2-0. Checked a swing on a breaking pitch, but he did not in there for a strike. 2-1. That was a really late call by the home plate umpire, and Coach Stankiewicz not happy with it. And now the bench barking at Mattingly. And we've seen Coach Stankiewicz a couple of times get really upset on check swings. And now Mattingly saying he's done with everybody jawing at him. Did he throw somebody out of a game? Or is that just a warning? And now Mattingly hollering at Andy, and Andy just raises his hands. And so we got the right count, 2-1. Well, it was a weird call by Mattingly. He's had an interesting game behind the plate, to say the least, tonight. The 2-1. 3-1. But it was just a weird call. The way he called it, he didn't ask down to third base. And I think that's what really upset Coach Stankiewicz is he didn't ask for any help down there on a check swing. Maybe he called it a straight strike. I don't know. 3-1. Popped up left side. Is it going to get out of play? It is. 3-2 count here. Two outs. Nobody on. A run already across. And 5-0 GCU lead. Swing and a miss. He struck him out. Second strikeout of the ball game for Howard. Well, one run comes across on one base hit there. No errors and nobody left on base. We have completed six. 5-0 GCU with the lead. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
Hello, Phoenix. This is Jerry Colangelo from Grand Canyon University. You can join the GCU community by enrolling as an evening student at our beautiful campus in the heart of Phoenix. Earn your bachelor's, master's, or doctoral degree to take your career to the next level. Engage with industry expert instructors and get the support you need to excel. I look forward to seeing you on campus.
Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Visit gcu.edu/evening.
Gorgeous Phoenix night here. The Final Four is in town, starting tomorrow, tipping tomorrow. We got a three-game set here between the Bears and the Lopes, and GCU up 5-0 as we go to the seventh. Jake Wong back on the hill underneath the moonlight and the lights of Brazel. Wong staked that 5-0 lead, hoping to cruise to his third victory of the year, and it would be his first win since he got that W up at St. Mary's on the 5th of the month. Jack Pauley, Brett Minnick, and Nick Tanner, 4, 5, and 6, heart of the order here. Pauley hit a shot to the wall in left, bounced off the scoreboard. Wyatt got his glove up there, couldn't come up with it for a double in the fourth. He ground out to first in the second. Little flare, shallow left, Mumper ranges out, makes the grab. Well, that's an easy way to do it. One pitch, one out for Jake Wong. Let's take a look at Jake's pitch count as Brett Minnick steps up to the plate. Minnick, 0-for-1. He walked in the second and struck out looking in the fourth. This is down low, 1-0. Wong at 86 pitches. We heard Coach Stankiewicz in a post-game show after Jake had thrown over 100 pitches. Swing and a miss, 1-1. Say that they're really trying to lengthen out Jake's outings. They would love to see him throw over 100 pitches and continue to get that arm strength and that stamina up as their Friday night guy, the 1-1. Chop foul. Might have caught somebody back behind there. 1-2 the count to Brett Minnick. One and two the count to Minnick. The pitch in the air, right center. LaRouge, the ball's fading away on the run, tracks it down and makes the grab. Boy, Tom is fun to watch as he just covers ground out there in center field. Got a good jump and easily tracked it down. That ball bending away from him off the bat of the right-hander. That'll bring up Nick Tanner with two outs. Tanner 0-for-2, a fly out to center and a ground out to second. I'd imagine, as that pitch misses away, if Wong can get through this inning unscathed here and fairly quickly, he'll be back out there again. 92 pitches on the night. Tanner hitting 220 on the year. One homer, 9 RBI. Fouled back, 2-1. Had a good cut on that, but good placement by Wong. No action in the bullpen down there. Everybody's out there hanging out. But no action in the pen. Two one pitch. Fouled off, count goes to 2 balls and 2 strikes. Right there. Upstairs, 3-2 the count. We are in the top of the seventh, and it's 5-0 GCU. Jake Wong looking for his sixth strikeout of the night. The 3-2. Chop foul. Tanner spoils it there. We'll do it again. 3 balls, 2 strikes. 2 outs, nobody on. We're in the seventh. The pitch. Foul back. Tanner having a nice at bat here. Well, Jake got him 1-2-3 in the first. Struggled with this control in the second, third, and fourth, but never really had too much concern. Fouled off again, 3-2. And the last two innings, he's gone 1-2-3. Has retired the last 10 batters that he's faced. Ground ball right side, dive off the glove. Bulls got it, throws to the covering Jake Wong and gets the out. What a play by the Lopes defensively. 3-4-1 on the put out. Bull, Johnny on the spot. Wong stayed with it, covered the bag. High fives all around as we go to the bottom of the seventh. Jake Wong has retired 11 in a row, and the Lopes lead it 5-0 here at Brazel. Well, folks, get ready to laugh out loud. Are you ready? Comedian and singer-songwriter Tim Hawkins is coming to GCU Arena April 1st. That's tomorrow for April Fool's Day comedy concert. Shows guaranteed to entertain your entire family. Tickets start at $18 with meet and greet options available. Go to the Arena box office or GCUArena.com. Student discounts and group discounts available. Fans enjoying Take Me Out to the Ballgame here as we go to the bottom of the seventh. Lopes up 5-0. Tyler Wyatt, Zach Mallison, Quinn Cotton. Wyatt to lead things off for GCU. He is 0-for-2 in this one, but he did walk and score a run. But boy, I tell you what, Tyler Wyatt has been playing incredibly well since getting back into the starting lineup. Wyatt against Bakersfield hits.
Rips that one in the corner. It's thinking two. Bobbled out there by Penner, and he strolls into say on that double by Meyer. Back in the second, or on the throw, reached out for it. Oh, yeah, good
definitely
call.
Definitely safe. Great call there by Stelgis.
Tomorrow, we'll have to find out tomorrow. I will not be here, but Fletcher will take you home starting at noon tomorrow.
So Ty Wyatt to lead things off here for GCU, playing in left field. He popped out to the catcher in the first, struck out swinging in the third, and walked and scored, leading off the fifth. He was the first man to face Jacob Howard. He'll face him here. First pitch is outside, ball one. Popped up, foul. Burkhardt coming over, taking a look, but out of play. 1-1. Well, a couple guys throwing down there in the pen. Lopes with a 5-0 lead. A.J. Franks and then somebody just loosening down there. Still wearing their jacket. Franks is throwing. 2-1 count to Wyatt. We'll see if Wong is done or not when we go to the 8th. 2-1 up high, 3-1. Well, I always try to figure out what Coach Stankiewicz is going to do. And I rarely get it correct. Last time I asked him, you know, why Wyatt or why Wong came back out after he'd already thrown 100 pitches, he said, well, we want to try to, you know, get that stamina. He's our Friday night guy. He's our horse. We got to, you know, ride him. We got to get him going over 100 pitches. So, chance here tonight is Wyatt walks to lead off the inning just like he did back in the fifth. Second time he's been aboard today. So, I would expect that Jake Wong is going to come back out in the eighth, but I will probably be wrong the way A.J. Franks is throwing down there. Zach Malice at the plate with Wyatt at first. Malice will fly out to right his last time up. Had a bunt single and scored a run in the fourth and struck out in the second. Strike one. Wyatt takes his lead. Howard, snap throw over there. Wyatt back. Wyatt on the season, 0 for 1, stolen bases. Ripped to the first baseman. Minnick steps on the bag. Gonna have to make the tag. Throws it away. Wyatt up quickly. Gonna go for third. No throw. So Wyatt takes second on the ground out by Malice. Takes third on the E3 by the first baseman, Brett Minnick. Boy, Minnick right on it. Fields the ball. Steps on the bag. As you see the throw here, a good throw would have got him. Would have been tight. Wyatt very quickly up and down to third. So the Lopes with one out have a man on third base. That'll bring up Quinn Cotton. Second error of the ball game. That should be the third error, I think, of the ball game, right? Charge to the Bears in the air. Wyatt's going to tag. Not as deep. Tanner going to come up throwing. Could have a play at the plate. Wyatt gets down. Safe. And that is run number six. Well, once again, Mattingly took forever to call him safe there and wanted to make sure Wyatt touched the bag, but 6-0. Wyatt, you saw in that video package we played, scored very similar on a closer throw, that slide where he comes by and reaches out and grabs the bag. Didn't have to do it there, but comes in to score. So Wyatt's walked twice and scored twice in this ball game. Give Quinn Cotton the sack fly and the RBI, and it is 6-0 GCU. Two outs, Josh Meyer at the plate. The air comes back to haunt the Bears. First pitch in there, strike one. Meyer struck out in the second, had a sack bunt in the fourth, and drove in a run with the fielder's choice in the fifth. Inside, 1-1. So Lopes in charge here, going to run away with it. And there for a strike. Meyer thought it was low. 1-2. Josh in 280 on the year. So looking for his first home run. Chopper. Third baseman's got it. The throw over in the dirt. Scoop nicely by Minnick. Bails out his third baseman, Burkhart. And that is the inning. But a leadoff walk by Wyatt. A ground out in there, and then a sack fly brings him home. So Lopes get one run on no hits. There was one error and nobody left on base. We go to the eighth inning. 6-0 GCU with the lead. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
Time. Time never stops, never slows down. We spend time on the things we love and the people who need us. The time we spend is precious, and before we know it, it's gone. But every end has the promise of a new beginning. It's time to create a better future. A new beginning awaits. Seize it. GCU's online degree program puts you first, so you can make the most of your time. Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University.
Six nothing, GCU leads Northern Colorado as we go to the eighth. And Jake Wong back on the hill for the eighth inning of work, sitting on 99 pitches. So I said I'd try to guess what Coach Stankiewicz is going to do, and I guessed correctly. I wasn't confident in my guess, but I was correct. Wong back out there. He'll face the bottom three, Alex Keel. Matt Burkhart and Tyler Yamaguchi due up for Northern Colorado. So Jake with the chance here to get another quick inning, and kind of doubt they'd throw him back out there for the ninth, but you never know. See how many pitches he has to go through here. Keel will lead things off. Jake has retired the last 11 in a row after a double in the fourth. No one has reached base. Keel 0 for 2 tonight. Upstairs, ball one. A ground out to third and a ground out to second. Chop foul, 1-1. Keel in 254 on the year. No homers, 4 RBI. Big swing and a miss on a high fastball. 1-2. Eight. Franks continues to warm down in the pen for GCU. In the air. Center field shallow. Coming in LaRouge. Coming in Wyatt. LaRouge calls everybody off. Makes the grab, and that's the first out of the inning. Now 12 in a row retired by Jake Wong. That'll bring up Burkhart. Burkhart 0 for 2. This bottom third of the order, specifically. Now with that fly out to center field. 0 for 7. And now Kai Correa is going to call his hitter down and have a chat with them. Josh Meyer takes the time to go out and chat with Jake Wong. Well, for Jake, it's very interesting. He was pretty sharp in the first, really struggled through the second, third, and even the fourth. But, boy, since then, he hasn't seemed like the same Jake as far as just constant control and command of his pitches. But, boy, he's made some really nice pitches, pitched out of some jams. And, as we mentioned, retired 12 in a row here. Burkhart at the plate. In 182 on the year. First pitch, strike, outside corner. Two ground outs to short for Burkhart, so Mumper better be ready. Shot right back up the box. Almost took a part of the upper body of Jake Wong with it, but that's the first hit since the double by Pauly back in the fourth, and that is going to be it. Well, they were giving Jake as long until he gave up a base hit. Now Coach Stankiewicz is going to come out and say that's going to do it for Jake Wong. So he'll leave with a 6-0 lead, but he's responsible for Burkhart down there at first base. So Burkhart with the base hit single up the middle. And Wong is going to be done after retiring 12 in a row. First base hit against Wong since Jake Pauly got a double back in the fourth. So A.J. Franks is going to come in. Another fantastic outing for Jake Wong. I mean, as he heads to the bench now and collects a ton of high fives, low fives, slaps on the back. 7 1/3, just 2 hits given up in this ball game by Jake Wong. 1 walk, 5 Ks, no runs. He is responsible for the man down there at first base, Matt Burkhart. But just a phenomenal outing, and A.J. Franks on the hill for GCU. Franks, 6'2", senior at Anaheim, California, and Santa Ana College. A.J., a 3.63 ERA, a record of 2-0. This will be his 14th appearance in 22 1/3. He's given up 25 hits, 10 runs, 9 earned, walked 3, and struck out 12. Opposition hitting 294 against Franks. So A.J. Franks trying to come in and close things out for the Lopes here in the eighth, leading at 6-0. And you're looking at tomorrow night's starter. Jake Repovich has been charting pitches here. Rep will be on the hill tomorrow at 2 o'clock. Repovich has pitched well for GCU, coming in a record of 2-2, a 4.14 ERA, and That great pickoff move.
The 1-2. Swing and a miss on a pitch low. Unable to close it out. Might have got him, and they did. Great. Gap in left center field. Swing and a miss. Boy, it looks like that go-to pitch.
Got a couple. Didn't have a sharp command, but boy, what a gutsy performance through 5 1/3 and got the victory for GCU. Repovich will be on the hill tomorrow, standing there next to Coach Stankiewicz. Charting the pitches, taking a look at the hitters, seeing how he wants to attack guys tomorrow. But first things first, GCU need to get this one in the books. They lead a 6-0 with one out and a man on here in the eighth. Got a pinch hitter coming up for Tyler Yamaguchi. It is number 20, Peyton Tapia, the 6'2", 215-pound junior out of Fort Collins, Colorado. First pitch from A.J. Franks. Chopper, foul. Malice reaches up and grabs it. Gets a cheer from the crowd on that foul ball. Tapia, the pinch hitter, hitting .242 on the year with one home run and 5 RBI. And comes in to hit for Yamaguchi, who is 0-2 against Jake Wong. Swing and a miss by Tapia, 0-2. Burkhart down there at first. Tapia down in the count. Swing and a miss. Struck him out. So Franks comes in, strikes out the pinch hitter. Two outs now. Top of the order, Dean Lawson. Well, we keep an eye on this, and women's basketball, UConn down by 2 in overtime with about 30 seconds left to Mississippi State. A lot of nervous folks there with UConn. What have they won, like 900 games in a row or something like that? 111? Well, UConn will have the ball with 30 seconds left. See what Gino Auriemma can pull up here. Two outs here. Lawson at the plate, the 1-0. Misses 2-0. Lawson 0-2. A couple of strikeouts and was hit by a pitch. Ground ball, gloved by Franks. The easy pitch over to first, and that's the inning. Nice glove work by the reliever, A.J. Franks. Comes in, everybody chuckling, snags that one, and the easy toss to Evans. Well, the crowd's gonna sing some Sweet Caroline here with the Lopes up 6-0 as we go to the bottom of the eighth. West Side Story, the classic tale of a turf war between rival teenage gangs, opens in Ethington Theater tonight. This spin on Romeo and Juliet has been captivating audiences for decades, and this production will be no exception. Get your tickets now at gcu.edu/west. That's West Side Story, gcu.edu/west. Lopes up 6-0, couple of changes here. The new pitcher on the hill. We'll get you all those changes in a moment here. The good crowd still sticking around with the Lopes up 6-0 here in the eighth. Yeah, a few of them are into it. Some of them are just chatting. I think they're enjoying the weather and the camaraderie. Justin Mulvaney, the new pitcher, number 24, the 6-foot junior out of Arvada, California. So Mulvaney in to take over for Howard. We also had Billy Moreland, I believe, out of shortstop, taking over for Yamaguchi, who was pinch hit for in that eighth inning. want to remind you folks, follow us on Twitter, GCU_Lopes, and the baseball Twitter handle, GCU Baseball, that's easy to remember. Because before every ball game and now after every ball game, I'll be talking to the skipper, Andy Stankiewicz, for sure before every ball game. And then once we get that, we'll shoot that out, tweet that out, and you can listen to it and hear the coach's thoughts before the ball game. And then after every ball game, we'll talk to Coach Stankiewicz, some players, some of the assistant coaches, a few or all, and we'll tweet that out and also put that in the final game story on GCULopes.com. So look for that tonight and follow us on Twitter, GCU_Lopes and GCU Baseball. First pitch to Mumper. Misses. Ball one. Get to Justin Mulvaney's numbers in just a moment. Inside ball two. Mulvaney, 10.29 ERA, a record of 1-2. This is his sixth appearance. Does have one start under his belt. In seven innings, Mulvaney's given up 12 hits, 9 runs, 8 earned. He's walked 3 and struck out 5. Opposition at 375 against him. And so far, nothing's been close for Mumper to take a cut at. Mumper 0-2, a walk and a couple of strikeouts. Hitting 136 on the year, playing stellar defense in there for a strike. 3-1. The Utah Valley has already lost twice, so they go to 3-2 on the year. Sac State beat them twice, so they go to 2-3. Strike on the outside corner, 3-2. Bakersfield won 6-5, so they go to 1-3 on the year. UTRGV 0-4 on the year. Timeout called there before the pitch. And Seattle loses at home, 6-2 to New Mexico State. Seattle now 1-3 on the year. New Mexico State picks up their first conference win, 1-0. Inside, he walked him. So I have been incorrectly saying that there will be one undefeated team in the WAC at the end of the night. So I correct myself there. So it really is not a mistake if I correct myself, right? We're going to go with that. There will be two undefeated teams. New Mexico State will be one of them, although they might not have enough games to qualify. I'm really trying to get myself out of making a mistake here, and I think I've done a nice job. Austin Bull. That's how you do it. You just make something up and then you praise yourself. I went in there for a strike to Bull. Bull's having a great night after a couple of lineouts to left and right. He's got a single that produced a couple runs and came in to score in the fourth, and then singled, stole the base, and scored in the sixth. Bounced in there. 1-1 to count to Bull, hitting 385 on the year. On base percentage of 472. That has got to be up there. Incredible on base percentage for Bull. Getting on base nearly half the time he's up. 1-1. Bounces away from the catcher. Mumper easily takes second on the wild pitch. And it goes to 2-1. And now UConn scored. So it's 64-64 with 12.3 seconds left. And Mississippi State, I believe, has the basketball. The 2-1. Fouled off. 2-2. They just showed a stat that said UConn's lost last 5 overtime games they played in. In the air, hit pretty well, coming over, that's going to fall. Mumper had to hold, so now he's going to hold at third. So third single in a row for in last 3 at-bats for Bull. Now you got runners at the corners. I'll bring up Tom LaRouge. And Mississippi State hits a jumper at the buzzer. UConn goes down. 66-64. 111 wins in a row? Gosh, come on. Couldn't win 112? I think that streak might last for a while until Geno breaks it, 5 years from now? Pitch in there for strike one to LaRouge. Tom having a nice night, too. Boy, this top of the order's fantastic for GCU. Tommy hitting 340 now with one homer and seven RBI on the season. Swing and a miss, 0-2. LaRouge had a base hit single in the first. He flew out to left in the third, had a single that brought in Bull in the fourth, and then a ground out in the sixth that moved the runner over to third and allowed Bull to come in to score on a sac fly. A flare into center field. Tanner coming over, going to make the grab. Mumper's going to tag. He'll come in to score. No throw. 7-0 GCU. Sac fly LaRouge. Second RBI of the ball game for Tom LaRouge. And the Lopes extend their lead. And it'll bring up Ian Evans. Good to see that the Lopes, after getting those three into the fourth, have continually tacked on a run. The fifth, the sixth, the seventh. Evans at the plate had a sac fly back in the sixth. That brought home Bull with the fifth run of the ballgame. Evans walked in the fourth. A couple of ground outs in the first and third. Two and oh. Well, we mentioned tomorrow's matchup. Jake Repovich on the hill for GCU and showed you some of his highlights. And boy, what a great year Jake's having. In the air, right center field, coming over the center fielder. Tanner making the grab. Then dropped the ball. Oh, they're saying now that he dropped it. He didn't catch it. And once again, late calls by the umpires, and it's a double play to end the inning. Are you kidding me? Well, it looked to me like Tanner caught the ball. It looked to me like Tanner caught the ball and then dropped it, taking it out of his glove. We're going to take a quick look at it here. As the ball comes in, we'll slow it down. Oh, my goodness, that's a horrible call. Horrible call as we end the inning. Tanner caught it as he's going down to take it out of his glove. The ball drops out, but it goes as a double play. So Tanner alertly saw the bad call by the officiating crew and made the throw. Well, shouldn't matter. Lopes up 7-0. We go to the ninth. A.J. Franks on to try to end this ballgame and give the Lopes their fourth win in conference play. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV and the WAC Digital Network.
There's an exciting new destination for food, fun, and relaxation in the heart of Phoenix. Come to GCU Hotel and Canyon 49 Grill, where our hospitality management students gain hands-on workplace experience and deliver unmatched service right alongside the staff. Enjoy beautiful amenities like the resort-style pool and full-service fitness center. From the gaming lawn and patio to the artisanal coffee and teas of GCBC, you'll never want to leave. Room rate $79 per night. Visit GCUhotel.com to book your visit today.
Well, Lopes up 7-0, and it's good they are, because we ended the eighth with a, I don't know, call I've really never seen, a very obvious call, the center fielder catching the ball and just moving the ball into his glove, or his hand, down toward his hand to pick it up and throw it. They said that he dropped the ball, and so it was basically an 8-6-3 double play, but Frank saw it to face Johnson, Maltese, and Pauly trying to end this ball game and give the Lopes a lead, up 7-0. First pitch, a nice cut. Fouled back by Johnson. The same two teams match up tomorrow. Repovich, 2-2 with a 4.14 ERA. Troy Watson, 3-1 at 5.64 ERA. Strike on the outside corner. That was a weird play to end that inning because, I mean, Bull had gone halfway, started coming back, and Evans had already run all the way to the dugout. Yump didn't make any demonstrative call at all. Little chopper to first. Evans has it. Two outs away. And then Gary Gilman just kind of put his hands up like safe and then stood around and waited for the 8-6-3 double play. Evans, a nice glove work there. And Bears down to their final. Two outs. Cole Maltese at the plate. Maltese, a strikeout victim in the first, lined out in the fourth to the second baseman Bull and flew out to left in the sixth. Chopper, going to be a tough play. Malice gloves it. Not as tough as I might have made it out to be, as Malice, Johnny on the spot. One out away for the Lopes to go in 4-0 in WAC play this year. Malice had a beat on that the whole way. Took his time, didn't rush it. And see, the first base coach not happy with that at bat by Cole Maltese. And Jack Pauley. Pauley almost bounced one off the wall of the scoreboard back in the fourth. Wyatt was all the way back. It was back against the wall and got his glove on it. That one missed outside ball one, but couldn't come up with it. Pauley one for three. A ground out to first. A double off the scoreboard in the fourth. And pop out to the shortstop in the seventh. Hit pretty well, but might have got under. LaRouche coming over. It's bending back. Does he have room? Reaches up. It's off the wall. Gary's got it back and up to play, and it's another double for Pauley. Well, Pauley bouncing him off the walls. Keeps it alive. Trying to end the shutout here. So Pauley, the DH, back at second. Boy, this kid's got all kind of power. Jack Pauley has four home runs on the year, but just flirted with two here in this game already. Then we got Brett Minnick. Minnick's got a couple home runs too. See if Franks can shut it down here and get Jake Wong his third win of the year. Don't want to give the Bears anything to be happy about going into tomorrow either. This is outside ball one. You know, they string a couple hits together and score a run or two, and they start feeling good about themselves tonight. I'm back here tomorrow at 2. Fouled off. AJ taking his time. Two outs here in the ninth. 2-1, missed outside. Three and one the count now. To Brett Minnick. Minnick, a walk in the second, a strikeout looking in the fourth, and flew out to center in the seventh. Fouled off. Count goes full. Three balls and two strikes. Well, Franks can get the job done here. The Lopes will only have to use two pitchers in this ball game as Wong went 7 1/3. Bullpen will be intact for tomorrow. Bears have used three pitchers, the 3-2. Fouled off again. So now Minnick staying alive. Minnick hitting 291 on the year. He's got those two homers we mentioned and 16 RBI. Ground ball to short. Mumper's got it. Throw to first. There's your ball game. Jake Wong goes 7 1/3 innings, only two hits. He gave up a double in the fourth to Pauley and a base hit single in the eighth to Burkhardt. No runs, one walk, five Ks. He threw 105 pitches, 69 four strikes. And Jake Wong gets a victory. He goes to 3-1 on the year. Aaron Hamilton gets a loss. He goes to 2-2, same two teams. Back here tomorrow, and they will face off at 2 o'clock. Troy Watson on the hill for the Bears. Jake Repovich on the hill for GCU. So thank you so much for tuning in. We got more baseball tomorrow on GCU TV at 2 p.m. Lopes get the victory, 7-0. They win their fifth in a row and stay perfect in conference play at 4-0. Thanks to Gina and Scott. Running things downstairs. We got two JPs, JP Saar and JP Edge, and thanks to Riker for running the cameras. Follow Grand Canyon University on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/GCU. I'll be interviewing the coach and some players, and we'll have that out for you on Twitter and on the wrap-up at GCULopes.com. Lopes win it, 7-0. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night. We'll see you tomorrow, too. Go Lopes.